Hi guys, what's up? We haven't done one of these videos in a really long time, and that's why I posted this question on my story asking what you guys would like to hear about next. And it was hands down do-it-yourself skincare. And to be honest, I was really happy and thrilled because it's one of my favorite ways and approaches to skincare. I have been doing these mixes of all kinds of things from the kitchen since I was probably 14. I think that's what's actually inculcated this passion that I now have towards skincare and towards holistic beauty. Skincare that you, I mean, not skincare exactly, but you know, packs and face masks and a whole lot of concoctions that you could make yourself in the kitchen are extremely simple, really easy to get done. You don't need much. They may or may not be the most effective for your skin, but for me, it's been an absolute go-to since, like I was saying, 14. And I still do a lot of the same things. Some of the things have been tweaked, some of the recipes are tweaked as my skin concerns have changed or the seasons change. So today I thought I'm going to share a couple of my favorites when it comes to skincare and a couple about hair care. So here goes. So I just want to tell you guys before we start that, you know, all of these ingredients that we're going to use for the different packs and oils and things like that, they're all natural. They're spices, things you find in the kitchen cabinet, in the fridge. So I would highly recommend that you do a patch test if you haven't before, because they can have adverse reactions. It's not a clinical formulation where you can be absolutely sure of the concentration of each and every ingredient in that bottle. So as much as you know, it's pure and it's natural, it may or may not suit you. So I would really recommend that you try it out once before. We don't want any strange reactions. Another thing that I do want to tell you is, because we're using like I said, things from the kitchen and from the fridge and things like that, definitely make sure that they're all washed. Please make sure that your hands are washed and your nails are clipped. You don't want any bacteria party going on over there. And as well as all the utensils that you use, you know, we kind of overlook that. And make sure that if there are any spices that we're using, you try and get the purest one possible. So the first do-it-yourself pack that you can make is as simple as two ingredients, which is honey and haldi. Now honey, as you all know, is a natural humectant, and haldi is anti-inflammatory, antibacterial, a whole lot of good stuff in that little yellow powder. I like to use it for when I have zits. You know, sometimes you have like muddy looking skin, your skin is just not looking clean, it's not looking fresh. So I like to just mix haldi and honey, a pinch of haldi and a little bit of honey. Please ensure that the honey is pure. I like to use this haldi. It's Aikadong turmeric from Spirit of the Tribe. It's on my Amazon found it page. I'm going to just link it for you there. It's from Nagaland and Meghalaya. It's apparently one of the richest forms of curcumin found in turmeric, so I really like it. It is the brightest yellow that you can find. It does stain your nails, but that's great because you know that it's pure, and at the same time it doesn't leave a lasting yellow on your face. It just makes you look really bright. So I actually did this 2 days before because we all get zits, and I was feeling like my skin needed a pick-me-up. So I mixed the haldi and the honey, applied it on my face. Because the haldi doesn't completely dissolve in the honey, it is a little granular, and I actually liked the exfoliation that it gave me. And trust me, when I wiped it off, I left it on for about 20 minutes. When I wiped it off, I couldn't believe the supple look that my face actually had. The second one is a family favorite. It is kacha doodh. Now that's raw milk. I have seen my mom putting raw milk on her face ever since I can remember. It was her go-to remedy for anything, and it still is. So whether it's sunburn, it's an uneven tan, your skin is feeling dry, or it's just not feeling healthy, she used to do this every morning. She still does. She just takes a bowl of kacha doodh, a little bit of cotton, and dabs it all over her face, which is what I do now. And as soon as it dries up, you kind of top it up and do it again till you finish the milk that you have left in your bowl. It's truly up to you how much milk you want. I like to use about 3 tablespoons of milk, and I like to add a little bit of rose water because I personally don't like the smell of raw milk anymore. So that's what I put on my face, especially when you have dry flaky skin, a sunburn. I even put it on my kids when they've played way too much in the sun and they get a sunburn. So it's great for making sure that your skin looks rested, moisturized. It gives you an instant glow, and it's all because of the lactic acid. Now everyone is running after acids in products and in bottles. Trust me, as long as you get great quality milk and you put it all over your face, it's gonna do wonders. It leaves your skin squeaky clean and supple. You can do this every morning. That's how my mom does it. She swears by it. The third one is more of a ritual, like a facial, than just a simple mask. I've been doing it for a couple of years now. I've never actually gotten a facial. I remember when I was getting married and everyone was like, oh, you must do this facial, and you know, there's this concept of bridal facial, and I was like, no way, I'm not letting anybody touch my face. I don't know what they're gonna do to it. In the run-up to the wedding day, I actually just did like this chironji scrub mixed with masoor dal and milk on my body every single day. It just kind of removes all the dead skin. And that's essentially all that I did. So I really didn't have any bridal facial going on. So coming back to my facial, my approach to a facial. So it's a couple of steps. Now I start off by cutting a nimbu and putting it on my face straight there. Because once you start putting it, the nimbu fibers kind of become brush-like. So it's really easy to put. If you have sensitive skin, you may want to try it out or dilute the lemon juice because it's highly acidic. First put the nimbu. It does sting, but I like that. I actually like the after effect of it, which is squeaky clean skin. Once I'm done with the lemon juice and I've removed it from my face, I like to put on a mask. Now this mask is basically besan and dahi. That's the basis for this mask, and you can add just about anything depending on your skin condition or your preferences. I like to put whatever I have available at that point of time. So it's besan, dahi, and orange peel, sandalwood powder, moringa powder, neem powder. Sometimes I tend to put a little bit of saffron, some rose water, again to cut the smell if you're bothered with smell. And you just mix it up, put it on your face. My kids love looking at me when I have a face mask. They get a really good laugh. And once it's semi-dry, I would not recommend that you let it get completely dry because then it's quite abrasive on your skin and you're gonna wet it anyway to remove it. Once it's semi-dry, I would recommend that you just kind of, you know, rub it off your skin and then use whatever dough-like consistency is there to remove the rest of the mask. So it's sort of like a scrub, but not as exfoliating in a granular way, but yes, it does kind of remove a lot of the dead skin, and for me that really really helps. Following the mask, I like to put tomato juice. So you just cut a tomato, again straight on your face, And again, it's the malic acid in the tomato that really, really works. I let the tomato be on my face for another 10-12 minutes. Remove that, and then the last step is aloe vera. So the aloe vera just cools your skin, tightens it, tones it. And once I've removed the aloe vera, I can feel that my skin is breathing. It's really, really refreshed. And don't forget to put all the stuff on your neck as well. There's no point you just do your face and you forget your neck. I like to do this like once in 2 weeks because it does take quite a bit of time. Now coming to a do-it-yourself oil for your hair. I've actually linked this hibiscus hair oil in my highlights. It's under the Bare Beauty section. Basically, I had a bunch of hibiscus bushes outside my house. And I've always seen hibiscus as an ingredient for hair packs. So I thought, why not make it yourself? So I took some coconut oil in a pot, added 7 to 8 hibiscus leaves, and all the parts except for the green of 2 hibiscus flowers. And along with that, I added some methi seeds. Methi is great for your hair. Some curry leaves. Again, curry patta is really, really good for your hair and to encourage hair growth. And you can add some amla powder to it. You can add some neem powder. If you have Brahmi, I have Brahmi growing outside, so I'm going to be putting that in my next oil. And you just let it boil. Switch it off after one boil and then let it steep and cool down and transfer it to a jar or a bottle, and you can use that for your hair. The next one is actually a hair gel that my friend told me about. It's basically boiling about 1/2 cup of flax seeds in 1 patila of water and then reducing it down till it reaches like a gel-like consistency. And then you strain it through a channi and then you get this gel. Now she used the gel as a mask and I also used it as a mask on my roots and, you know, halfway to my hair. So I found that this gel was quite a good hack for baby hair, and you know, when you want your hair to look neat. Now you know I have issues with baby hair and I can't stand it, and if the baby brush hack is not working, then I like to use the gel. I think it's genius because you have it on, it's helping you keep your hair neat and it's nourishing your hair at the same time. So if you're one of those people who needs to keep your hair up in a ponytail or in a bun quite often, then I would really suggest that you try this out. Last one, guys, I know it's information overload, but this is super quick. You have an ugly zit that comes when just when you're supposed to go out somewhere and it's inflamed and it's red. I figured this hack out a couple of years ago when I was facing like serious PCOS like acne condition, and which was basil steeped in water. Basil again is anti-inflammatory. You just steep the basil in water, cool it down, take some cotton and dab it on whatever acne you have, and trust me, it's going to settle. It's not going to go away, but temporarily it's going to reduce the redness, it's going to reduce the bump. So rather than using those pens and things that, you know, actually end up leaving marks in the long run, it really helps. So if it's a Zoom call or you need to meet somebody, or like you're meeting, you're going on a date for the first time and you have an ugly zit that has decided to pop up, try this out. I have done it quite a lot of times and it really, really is effective for me. So these are my do-it-yourself skincare tips. Please try them out and tell me how it goes for you. Please be careful. Use the best quality of products that you can get your hands on and make sure your hands are clean. There's no better way than looking after your skin, using ingredients and items that are easily available. So it really is worth it to try these things out. It definitely is a good supplement in conjunction with your regular skincare routine. Sometimes you'll find that there are certain recipes that really get the job done. Try it out. And do write down in the comments below which one works for you. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. So take care, guys, and get back below.